Good morning. Today we will briefly discuss about the examination of a case of peripheral occlusive vascular disease. Before going to the topic proper, we will go to the definition of POVD. What is the definition? Involvement of any vessels in the body with supply, other than with supplying the heart and the brain. It comes under the definition of peripheral vascular disease. That means occlusion of any vessel involving the limbs, even the renal, the GIT, all these will come under the definition of peripheral occlusive vascular disease. But today we will be mainly concentrating on a peripheral occlusive disease of the lower limbs, which is a much more common clinical situation we commonly face in day-to-day life. Okay. So POVD of the lower limbs, we can say that. So coming to the history, you look at the patient. Age of the patient is very important. Usually there are two or three conditions we usually face as a part of peripheral occlusive disease. One is the thromboangitis of latrans, which is very less common these days. Atherosclerosis and diabetes. Okay. Diabetes induced atherosclerosis of peripheral disease, vascular disease. So younger people are usually involved, 40s or 30s and 40s. Chronic smokers are usually involved with the TA or Burgess disease. Atherosclerosis usually involves a little more oldish people, like 50s and 60s. And diabetes can involve in any people, it depends on the chronicity of the condition and other factors. So age of this patient, we will be concentrating on lower limbs, unilateral or bilateral. Usually, though it's a general disease, usually starts with one leg, maybe it can go to the other leg, can become bilateral also. So it's not necessarily be unilateral, it can be bilateral disease also. Now, what is the presentation? Why the patient has come to the hospital? Obviously, it's an occlusive disease. How will you decide whether it's a chronic disease or an acute limb ischemia? In a chronic limb ischemia, the patient will be having the symptom for quite some time. The symptoms which I am going to describe very shortly after this. Patient will be having the symptom for quite some time before, which gradually progresses in intensity. Finally, it precipitates to the present stage. Whereas an acute limb ischemia, the patient may not be having a disease pertaining to the limb ischemia prior to this, but may be having a disease history of treatment for some cardiac disease or unusual treatment before. And suddenly one fine morning, patient develops severe pain, swelling, the 5 or 6 P's, pain, paraparesthesia, paralysis, all these things. Suddenly the patient goes, this is acute limb ischemia. We will not be covering the acute limb ischemia today. So mainly then what are the, how will you proceed with history taking and examination of a chronic limb ischemia, okay. The main problem, pain is the main symptom of a patient. We call it claudication, isn't it? Claudios means I limp. Okay, so patient comes with a pain which produces limping of the patient, okay. So what is the reason for this claudication? As we know, the blood flow to the limb is reduced, so oxygenation is reduced, so anaerobic metabolites like substance P and lactate accumulate in the limb, which produce cramping type of pain in the muscles. These two words are very important. Cramping pain in the muscles. It's not anywhere else. It's in the muscles. So, according to this, you need to know certain things. How far the patient can walk. The typical history will be, before the patient was able to walk for quite some distance, gradually the distance comes down. This distance is called claudication distance. Gradually the distance comes down. Finally, it will reach the stage patient we will get pain even at rest. Okay. Now, this pain is not present in the first step. When a patient starts walking, it is not present during the first step of the patient. Only after walking for some distance, the pain will be there. Third, after taking rest, the pain disappears. The patient probably will be able to walk a little more distance, and then again the pain comes back. But one point here you want to remember, not all pains which produces pain on walking is due to claudication. There are so many conditions. Classically, there are three types of claudications described. One is the arterial claudication, the second is venous claudication, and the third is the neurogenic claudication. Arterial claudication is a history like this. Patient walks, gets pain, and the level of pain is also indicative of the site of occlusion. In arterial claudication, suppose the pain is in the calf, we can say that probably the occlusion is in the hypertrophic arterial femoral population segment. If the pain is in the thigh region, the occlusion is one step above, like maybe in the femoral artery. If the pain is in the gluteal region, we can say maybe the occlusion is in the iliac artery level. Again, it's the occlusion above, aortoiliac occlusion. The patient may get the pain in the gluteal region. Along with that, a condition called impotence. It's called a Leris syndrome. Okay. So the level of the pain is also important. Where exactly which muscle groups are really having problems? Just above that group of muscle, usually the pathology will be situated. Okay. So arterial claudication, there will be pain. Patient has to take rest, and usually the patient takes rest with the limb in a dependent position, holding the limb. That relieves the pain. Dependent position. That's the history you get in an arterial claudication. In venous claudication, again, it's due to the occlusion of the deep veins, MIT vein thrombosis, whatever. Pain comes, throbbing, sudden bursting pain after walking for some distance. Patient has to take rest to relieve the pain. But the pain is more relieved by keeping the limb elevated, because that position, the venous drainage is more facilitated. Okay, so that is the problem. Third claudication, this is neurogenic claudication due to neural canal stenosis. Okay. So in this condition, patient again gets pain. Patient has to take rest to relieve the pain. The pain is more relieved sitting and stooping forward. In that position, the pain of the neural canal has maximum diameter and pain will be relieved. So these are the three types of claudication. You have to differentiate from the patient. But much more common condition is arterial claudication. Then there are a lot of differential diagnoses for this claudication. As I told you before, not all conditions which produce pain on the limb, lower limbs by walking is due to claudication. There are so many conditions. Like, for example, any musculoskeletal problem on the limb, like an arthritis of the knee joint, ankle joint, muscle tear, or muscle inflammation, or lumbar disc prolapse with a shooting the lumbar, the neuralgic pain, all these are differential diagnosis. If you are not careful enough in taking history, this can easily be misunderstood as a cause of claudication. So how do you differentiate? In all these conditions, there will be pain on first step. In an arthritis, muscle tear, you don't have to walk for some distance to get the pain. Patient steps up of the chair, patient gets pain. And pain will be more localized to the joints or the ligaments, or radiating pain all along the lower limb in a disc prolapse. So if you take history properly, you can say that the pain is not in the first step, not exactly in the muscles, which is a feature of a claudication pain. And claudication can be graded according to Boyle's classification. Grade 1 is a patient gets pain, but after patient walks, and after walking for some more distance with pain, pain usually relieves because of metabolites are washed away. So patient can continue to walk. Second, patient can continue to walk with pain. Even if after pain, patient walks, but patient walks for some more time with pain. The third, grade 3, is patient has gets pain and patient has to take rest to relieve the pain. So that is the grading of the claudication. After claudication, the pain increases and a stage will reach when the patient gets rest pain. That is the stage when the nerves, also ROC scheme, previously we used to call the cry of the dying nerves and all this. Okay. Patient gets pain more in the night, and the pain will be more conspicuous on the foot region. Patient will ask. Usually the patient stays awake whole night holding the limb, the foot of the and patient will be sleepless because of the most common site is the foot. So that is the pain. Then again, further progress will patient get paresthesia, the nerve involvement, patient may get paresthesia of the limb. You ask about paresthesia. As I told you at the beginning, the definition, but the limb vessels are involved, other vessels are also likely to be involved. So you ask history about other involvement of other artery systems in the body, like eyes may be involved, like maybe a vision impairment, abdomen, the GIT, the splanchnic and the mesenteric vasculature may be involved. Patient may get postprandial pain of the abdominal pain, postprandial abdominal pain, renal artery stenosis, so renal impairment. So even other systems like cardiovascular and cerebral vascular disease can be there because of the generalized vascular disease, which is a part of this disease, maybe in atherosclerosis. So ask history about other vascular systems in the body. Also importance, I told you in aortic occlusion, in male patient can get that importance. So get a history regarding presence or absence of importance. Okay. So that is the history, general history. Ask history about all these diseases like vascular disease and all these things you should ask. And diabetes is very important. History you should ask. Hypertension, cardiac disease, cerebral vascular disease, renal disease, all this may be part of a common cause or effect of the arterial disease. Okay, so take history regarding all the pathology. Personally, is smoking is a very important history. You know, smoking can aggravate, can produce a condition called main causative factor for TAO is a smoking, but it can also aggravate all other causative factors like diabetes or atherosclerosis. So vascular occlusion is closely associated with the smoking. The amount and the type of the smoke is very important. The quantity and the quality and the duration, all these are important regarding the smoking. So very important history you should ask. Now, after this you come to the examination. General examination, you should see the attitude of the patient. Patient may be in pain. If it's in restrained state, patient will be sitting up, holding the leg. That's a classical posture of the patient. Patient sits up, holding the foot, not sleeping, not resting, always in pain. That is what you see in a chronic pain. If in a claudication stage, when you examine, patient may be symptomless because patient may be resting. At that point, patient may be attitude and appearance will be normal. But in resting pain, you should note whatever attitude. Okay. Local examination, you should examine, suppose the right limb is the problem, you should expose both limbs, you should be kept in a good, well-lit room, and good, after exposing the both sides, and you just start with the inspection. The most first thing you note is the color of the limb, normal color or not. The opposite, if the only symptom is only on one side, opposite side acts as a control. So you see the color, is there any ischemic color change, that is any darkish color or pale. Sometimes it will be too pale, maybe dark pale or early ischemia gathering, maybe darkish in color or cyanotic color. This you should know. You should always note the signs of ischemia of the limb. Chronic signs of ischemia like thinning of the hair, thinning of the skin, loss of hair, and atrophy of the nail, any non-healing ulcers, okay, loss of subcutaneous fat, any gangrene or necrotic area in the limb, all these are signs of a chronic ischemia that you should know. Then in inspection, you can do many tests. Many tests are described in books. I'm going to describe some of them. One is the Burgers test. What you should do, you should keep the patient flat on the bed. Normally, ask the patient to elevate the limb. Normal people, we are all can elevate the limb to your 90 or beyond 90. This will be no problem. You ask the patient, can do actively or passively elevate the limb. If it's very severe chronic ischemia of the limb, if you elevate the lower limb to particularly, maybe if it's less than 30, the patient's limb becomes pale, that is a positive test. That means the arterial circulation is not adequate. The patient develops pale color of the limb. And also veins become gutter, empty. This is a very significant. If it's because becomes pale and veins become gutter in less than 30 degrees, it's a very significant test. And if it is not becoming like that, you can ask the patient to exercise the toes and ankle at this 30 degree angle. At that point, the patient, the toes and ankle may become pale. In a normal patient, this will never happen. So exercising the toes and ankle, toes flexion and extension will produce pale color. So that again supports that there may be a significant ischemia to the limb. So that is a Burgers test. Next test is capillary filling test. You ask the patient to elevate the limb, the limb becomes pale, and ask the patient to sit up with the legs hanging. In a normal patient, it will never become pale on elevation, and on sitting up also, that if at all it becomes partly pale, it becomes normal color within no time. But in the POVD patient, it elevates, it becomes pale, and on sitting and legs hanging down, it takes a long time for the color to come back. Again, indicates an impaired arterial circulation to the limb. This is capillary filling. Venous filling can be inspected also. You are, again, the patient is lying on the couch, elevate, the veins become gutter, and keep the limb flat on the bed, flat, not dependent. Again, look for the time for the veins to get filled up. In normal people, it will be filled up very, very fast. If it takes taking a longer time for the veins to get filled up, that indicates impaired venous return, which is an indirect indication that the arterial circulation is impaired as well. Also, look for the color, as I told you, any signs of gangrene. If gangrene is there, is it dry gangrene or wet gangrene? Is there any active sites of infection? Is there any line of demarcation? That is a line between a gangrene segment and a normal segment. Is it line of demarcation as a tear? and also the limb above this gangrenous area. Suppose there is a gangrenous area around this foot. What has happened? So proximally, is it edematous, reddish color, is this any pale color or any darkish color extending into the lower part of the leg and above the ankle, should know which is an indication of an impending gangrene of the whole leg foot. Okay. So you should note that, inspect all this. Then go into the palpation, look for the temperature. Here is one condition, always we are talking about a raising temperature and tenderness, isn't it? Here is one condition, you may get a lowering of the temperature. Temperature on the affected limb may be low compared to the opposite side. Because of this ischemia, it may, if it is raised, that indicates an infection, isn't it? So temperature may be low. You can check the capillary filling by just pressing at the nail bed and see how much time it's taking for the blood to refill, the color to come back. In an ischemic limb, it may take a longer time. Venous refilling can be checked by two-finger technique. You know, you can press this area and empty the vein and release one hand and see, release the distal end and see how much time it is taking for the blood to fill the vein. It is a venous refilling time. In a normal individual, it won't take any time. Immediately you remove, the veins will be filled. But in a chronic ischemic limb, if you remove the distal finger, the veins may remain guttered for a longer period of time. And that will again indicate an indirect indicator of a chronic limb ischemia. Okay, next is the, you should palpate the gangrenous area. As we mentioned before in the examination of ulcer, you should palpate for any sensation loss, the ulcer itself, a gangrenous ulcer there. You describe that area, palpate, inspect, and describe all the areas, surrounding area, the margin, edge, floor, base, everything you should describe. And also look for any crepitus around this area, which is at this point when you palpate around the gangrenous area, look for any crepitus, which indicates a gas-forming organisms are acting. So that's again a bad sign of a ulcer. Palpate for the limb above. Is there any edema of the whole limb? Is there any tenderness extending beyond proximally the site of a gangrenous area or ulcer, which is again indicating of an infection spreading proximally? Okay. Any red color extending, edema extending proximally, you have to do see any tenderness if you see. The next step of examination of chronic vascular disease is a blood vessels. Okay. All the blood vessels, pulse in the body is very important. Thing you to see all the pulses in the body should be palpated, starting with the normal area or the affected limb, and all the pulses in the general. What are the characters usually look for in the pulse? The volume, the character, vessel wall, radiofemoral delay, all this may be important. Usually we describe all this in significant cases in surgery, but here this may be important. Volume is important. Any the character of vessel wall is important. Is it thick or not? Any delay between arterial pulse and one limb to opposite limb, that indicates maybe there is an occlusion somewhere in between. So all these are important. And suppose there is a very weak pulse in the lower limb. It may be due to one, maybe the arterial circulation is okay, but this pulse may be due to a collateral circulation. Chronic limb ischemia and it may produce collateral circulation. How will you know that? You make the patient to exercise for some time, walk for some time, then again feel the pulse. The pulse may have disappeared because the collateral circulation is not able to cope up with the increased demand of the arterial circulation at that point in time after exercise. This is called disappearing pulse. Okay. So when this pulse is in doubt, you make the patient exercise, re-examine the same pulse. It may have disappeared. This is called disappearing pulse. Okay. Now, what are the which are the vessels you palpate usually? The dorsalis pedis, where you palpate? In the dorsal part of the ankle, on the navicular bone, just lateral to the extensor hallucis longus tendon, just at the proximal to the metatarsal head, between the first and second metatarsal. Don't go too distal. If you go too distal, what happens? These dorsalis pedis artery will dip into the plantar surface joining the deep plantar arch. So you may not get it. In 10% of people, it's even absent normally also. So you should exactly look for, should know where exactly to look for the dorsalis pedis pulse. You can compare with the opposite side also. Okay. Then next is the posterior tibial artery. It is almost, it is in the medial aspect between the medial malleolus and the Achilles tendon, almost at the midway, against the calcaneal bone, you palpate. So you will usually get it. and both sides should be. But mind you, when the limb is edematous, sometimes it may be, even if it's present, sometimes it's difficult to palpate. So you should take that also into consideration. But if you keep on examining, you need little practice and experience to get these parts of it. So keep examining in normal people so that you know what are the normal parts. So once you get an abnormal case, you know it's abnormal or absent. Okay. Third is an anterior artery. Where will you look for? Midway between medial and lateral malleolus. Against the tibia, lower end of tibia, just above the line or angle joint line, just proximal to the joint line joining the angle joint. You palpate against the lower end of tibia, which is a difficult artery to palpate in normal individual also. So you should have, get a little practice to do it. Then is popliteal artery. Obviously, the name indicates popliteal artery will be palpated in the popliteal fossa. There are two or three methods. It's a, one you should know, it's a very difficult artery to palpate, because it's a deep seated artery close to the bone. So it's most very anteriorly situated in the, or deeply situated in the popliteal fossa. In normal individual, because of this, artery will be just palpable. In even normal individuals. If you're getting a very bounding pulse in a popliteal artery, that is an abnormality. Okay, that's an abnormality. Maybe there is a popliteal aneurysm. So you should know, keep it in your mind. You need a lot of experience to practice to do, get that popliteal pulse. How what you do? Patient is supine position, the limb is flexed to 40 degree. Keep your both hands in the popliteal fossa and palpate sideways towards the medial end of the, towards the lower end and medial side of the popliteal fossa. That is towards the, around towards the medial condyle of the tibia. You get the pulse. You will maybe just palpable. Pulse may be just palpable in a normal individual also. Maybe it's absent in a ventricular occlusive disease. That's method number one. Second is patient can be kept this prone position and the limb is flexed like this. Again, you can palpate deep in the popliteal fossa. You can palpate. The third test is a Fuchs test or cross leg test. Patient is asked to sit on the edge of a couch and the, this one knee is pressed against the other one. That examination finger at the lower leg will be kept on top and you look for the pulsation of the lower leg. Okay, so in a normal individual, because of the popliteal artery pulsate, the lower limb of the limb which is above will gently pulsate, can oscillate, can say, gently oscillate because of the pulsation. This is called Fuchs test or cross-leg test. So these are the three methods to see the popliteal pulse, which is a difficult artery to palpate normally. So whenever you get once on one side, you can compare with the opposite side. Suppose you are not getting on one side, what you do? Go and to opposite, normal side and palpate and compare. If you are getting on the other side, you should get it this side also. So that means it is absent on this side, is it? Okay. Then you should look for the femoral artery pulsation, the most proximal artery of a lower limb. Midway between anterior superior spine and pubic symphysis, just below the inguinal ligament, midway in the palpate. Usually you get a good bounding pulse in femoral artery in normal people. If you are not getting adequate volume and of the pulse compared with the opposite side, you are getting normal on that side, this side is reduced. It's an impaired pulse, isn't it? Usually the pulse is graded according to various grading systems, 0 to 4. Around 2 plus 0 is absent, 1 is less volume, 2 is normal, 3 is high volume, 4 is bounding pulse. That's the grading. So around, it's okay, grading is not very important, but you just remember that the grading, 2 plus is a normal pulse. So by practice, you know what is the normal bounding pulse, normal pulse, what is the reduced volume pulse, what's an absent pulse, what is the bounding pulse. Is by practice. Okay. So keep practicing on normal people, then you will come to know. Okay, now the pulses, we have examined the ischemic limb, we have examined the ulcer or gram area, any signs of ischemia, line of demarcation, the gangrenous area, everything. We have examined the arterial pulse. Or examine the neurological status, because as we mentioned, chronic limb ischemia, later stages, you can have neurological impairment also. Any neurological, sensory, motor, autonomic system impairment, especially in a diabetic foot, you may get autonomic impairment also. Loss of sweating, cracking of the limb, and motor system impairment like the wasting of small muscles of the foot, club foot, all these things you may occur. Hammer toe, all these deformities, and also sensational impairment. So you should check for neurological examination of the limb. Examine the lymph nodes, the regional lymph nodes, because of the gangrenous infected area, you may get lymph nodes palpable. Auscultate for any bruit. wherever you get a narrow vessel, we describe that what's Bruhi is an abnormal sound heard over an artery due to turbulence. The turbulence may be due to, in this case, a narrowing of the artery, which produces turbulence. So keep your stethoscope lightly or get inspected the artery which you want to examine. You will get a murmur-like sound over the, so Bruhi, you should now examine also. Now, I think that's how you examine arterial pulse. And then also don't forget to examine the gait of the patient. Any difficulty in mobilizing the joint again, maybe it's your stiffness, a claudication of the joint disease. Or patient may be an old age, people may also be having a chronic joint disease. So joint should be examined. Gait of the patient should also be examined. And measurement may be not very important in this case because there may be girth difference. Chronic limb ischemia can produce atrophy of the muscles and can produce that girth, reduction of the girth of the muscles if you do involvement of the muscles. Okay, because patient may be not walking metabolically. I think that completes the examination of a case of a peripheral vascular disease. After this examination, you will be able to tell us what is the condition of peripheral vascular disease involving which limb, probable occlusion at what position, probably what is the pathology. Because in young age, chronic smokers, GAO is common. Old age, bilateral disease, multiple system involvement, you may consider atherosclerosis. In diabetes disease, usually it affects very small vessels, microvascular system, and still there may be gangrene of the tip of the toe. So most common site of a peripheral vascular disease gangrene is the most distal part, isn't it? Around the tip of the toes and toes and foot. That's the area where you get gangrene in a peripheral vascular disease. If there's gangrene of the toe, with good pulse of the peripheral, sometimes that's what you get in a diabetes. Gangrene will be there, tip of the toe, but the pulse dorsal pedis and posterior will be present, and patient is diabetic. So you may have to consider diabetic gangrene in that situation. So finally, you will be able to tell us what common pathology, comorbidities are there, what could be the common pathology of this patient, and the level of occlusion. And that's how you put that diagnosis of a peripheral vascular disease. And further, you need a lot of investigation and management, which we will discuss in subsequent sections. Okay? So, I think this, when you get next time at peripheral vascular disease, try to do it systematically, what, like what we described today. Okay? Thank you.